direttore della divisione acque della UNESCO, Ms. Blanca Jiménez Cisneros, che introdurrà qualche breve parola prima del nostro evento, che poi continuerà con il progetto Let's Talk About Water. E thank you, Ms. Blanca.
Good afternoon, everybody. Just before these sessions, we were making a short video, and Linda was there. You will meet her very soon in more detail. And she was saying that his job consists on helping different scientists and engineers to communicate. And I, while she was speaking, I was thinking, I'm an engineer, that really is very hard to communicate. But the problem for any of us is the way in which we work is by communicating. If we don't learn to communicate, we won't be able not only to send a message, but we will never be successful in our lives. I'm the director of the Division of Water Science and secretary of the International Hydrological Program, which is the only intergovernmental program in the UN system dealing with the fresh water resources. In there we have to do three things. First, to be the interface between scientists and policymakers. The second is to promote capacity building, human resources and institutional capacity building. And the third one is to promote international cooperation. And for that, we need to communicate. So if you see, you really need to communicate, not only with your friends, you need to communicate with your colleagues, and you need to communicate what you want to do to improve the world, what you want to do to be successful in your life. And what, in this case, Linda will show you how we need to communicate to improve the management of freshwater resources. I'm very happy and thank you for inviting me to give some words. I'm also impressed because I was just saying now that most of the audience are women, so I'm happy about that, and I think it looks like the future will be changing. And well, thank you very much. Bye.
Very much. It's an honor for us to have the director here. And parlo italiano adesso. Questa lezione, diciamo, è una lezione congiunta di vari professori che gentilmente hanno voluto aiutarci e insieme riuscire a costruire questo evento. Quindi voglio ringraziare il professor Rolando Marini che ci ha ospitato nella sua lezione di sociologia della comunicazione di massa, ed in particolare che ha portato qui con noi, potete vederli, una parte della sua mostra fotografica titolata Acque Interiori. E veramente degli scatti bellissimi e delle opere per le quali ringraziamo molto di averle portate qui. Ringrazio anche il professor Batinti, che anche lui ha convogliato la sua lezione qui e che oggi anche con lui abbiamo inaugurato uno spazio nuovo di questa università che è l'Unifactory, e la professoressa Rita Stoppini, che è qui con i suoi studenti di italiano professionale, e la professoressa Piera Margutti, che la ringrazio moltissimo, con i suoi studenti di pragmatica interculturale. E quindi questo proprio per far capire che qui l'audience è variegato. Iniziamo stamattina, eravamo un po' più ingegneri, ma oggi pomeriggio abbiamo degli studenti che vengono da discipline molto diverse, e questo è il grande valore aggiunto di questa università, che ho l'onore di far parte di questo team, di questo staff, e spero che la giornata sia bella. Cominciamo con la nostra star, Linda Limpid, che è la creatrice e la coordinatrice del progetto Let's Talk About Water, e oggi ci mostrerà alcuni cortometraggi che riguardano appunto l'acqua, la risorsa idrica da lei indagata e studiata come forma comunicativa dal punto di vista scientifico, di ricerca universitaria. Linda ha un lungo curriculum che l'ha vista nei grandi musei del mondo a esporre, e anche con grandissimi registi, parliamo di Woody Allen, insomma, quindi abbiamo... Adesso con lei vi lascio, le lascio la parola, e poi anche gli altri professori interverranno, diciamo, la lezione aperta, è un momento di dibattito, quindi molto, molto informale, come proprio nelle cose anche dell'UNESCO, di questa audience internazionale, che sia anche di grande gusto e molto, molto accogliente. Quindi ringrazio Linda e le lascio la parola.
Thank you very much. And were you going to say a few words about your beautiful photos? Do you want to talk about them a little bit before I get started? Once I have the microphone, I am never shutting off and I don't get to nobody. I'd like to introduce Roland and let him say a few words about the beautiful photos. It's okay?
Yes.
I think this is the best one.
Non parlano la parola.
Yes. Grazie, mi ha voluto dare questo privilegio, io ho detto di voler parlare dopo. Cercherò di dire qualcosa in inglese e un po' qualcosa in italiano, perché non so dove. Sì,
in italiano.
Allora, vabbè. About the concept of landscape. In my opinion, when we tackle with this so difficult concept, we have to take into account that we can't exclude the human activities. They are deeply integrated in the landscape itself. And this is one of the most important problems. We can't conceive environment without including the human activities. There is an illusion that very frequently appears in the art vision, in the vision of arts, plural, arts, that tends to exclude the human activity. So, some visions of landscape tend to separate this element and to create a false landscape. In my artwork, this integration, this complementarity is fundamental, and this precisely this aspect becomes my investigation object. Quello che noi chiamiamo antropizzazione è quindi un problema preciso del paesaggio, non soltanto dal punto di vista scientifico, ma anche dal punto di vista artistico. This is a typical problem of the artistic approach and of the scientific approach. Ora, che cosa può significare l'acqua? Qui, anche per la mia esperienza come studioso di comunicazione, io tendo a rifuggire nel modo più assoluto da un approccio spettacolarizzante che sia quello tipico dei mezzi di comunicazione di massa più diffusi. Anzi, io propongo un approccio al paesaggio che proponga proprio una specifica esperienza estetica del paesaggio. Che è quella appunto del assorbire il paesaggio e proporre precisamente questa visione, quella appunto di soffermarsi, di indugiare, di immergersi e anzi di sentire la resistenza rispetto a quello che noi consideriamo consolidato e che diamo per scontato. Ecco, questa è la mia proposta che è una proposta essenzialmente estetica oltre che concettuale. E poi magari chi volesse saperne di più può consultare il mio sito, che è solo un sito fotografico, che è www.randomain.it. Thank you very much.
I would like to say that it's very hard when you don't understand the language to communicate. And so even how many of you actually speak English or understand English? Raise your hand. Oh, this is great. That's great. How many speak Italian? Great. And how many speak other languages? Also great. I want to thank you, Roland, for taking time to speak with us about your beautiful photographs. And you can see that images have a lot of power. And what we are talking about today is communication. And what's very exciting is that I tell you a little bit about myself, if I don't go too long. We have some films, three short films, and then we will have some experts come and say a few words and also ask you for questions. And I would like to ask you what you think is important in communication. Images, text. One thing about your generation is you are really deeply involved in communicating all the time. The minute you're out of the classroom, you're looking at your phones, you're looking at images, you're sending Instagram. You use Instagram here? Yes. People are very alive with communication. In academia, in science and engineering, people are stuck in the last century. And really, they need you to help them say, make it clear, make it simple. And the thing about hydrology is that we look at hydrology in scales, different scales, something small, something middle, something big. And in linguistics, which is studied at this school, you have the study of a dialect, one person's speech, where they're from, what that means, how we feel about that person who has a dialect. We talk to each other. We have interpersonal communication. We talk groups to groups, students to professors. That's another kind of communication. And then we have mass communication. And the thing about me is that I have done film and picture research, ricercatrice fotografica in filmi, or livello italiano, I know. And I have worked for 40 years in specializing science and history. I worked on an exhibit in a museum that was about global climate change way back in 1992. I realized it was a very complicated subject, and being from Brooklyn, I didn't think about nature. I'm from Brooklyn, New York. You know where that is? You've heard of New York? And I thought, nobody's going to understand this climate change business. I want to try to help. And what I realized is that water knits it all together. Water is a great entry point for this subject. I'm sorry, my back is here, my front is there. And so I realized that we should look at water as a way to link atmosphere, trees, plants, earth, rivers, lakes, groundwater, and be able to understand how the systems are interconnected, and also how the systems, in terms of the weather patterns, are interconnected, and to be able to somehow communicate that in a way that's exciting. And so I work with water scientists to make shows where we use films, and use the films to then bring the scientists up to the podium, and then they get very serious and very academic and blah, 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 blah. And so I say to them, no, speak more simply. Tell us what really you are studying in a language that I can understand. And they speak to each other very clearly, but they don't speak to a bigger public in a good way. And so I have felt, in the 10 years I've been working with this specific part of the project, that I've been pulling something that's very, very heavy. And then I got invited here. How did that happen? When you go to conferences, or even when you're in class, you meet a person next to you, and there is a chemistry. You know immediately you love that person. And that happened with Francesca Greco, who works with WAP at UNESCO here in Perugia. We met in Sweden, and within 5 minutes, we knew it was a friendship for life. Then six months later, she said, come to Perugia. I said, it's perfect, I'll be in Europe, I'm coming, and voila, here I am. But the reality is, how we communicate is very important. And I got invited years ago to be on the steering committee of an international program that was a competition for films made by young people about water. And I'm going to show some of them to you today, actually, some that are prize winners. There were three films. One was one of the winners. The second is what is called a scientific visualization. And the third is a spot that was done in India. So I'm going to roll the film, if that's okay with you. And I want you to watch as a critical audience. And then when we're done, I will discuss the films, and then we will have some of the specialists from your university come here and speak to you. Thank you very much. And then I will sing a song.
You guys are a wonderful audience.
Keeps our planet alive. The rivers are its arteries. Rivers run down mountains through forest, flow through desert and delta, course through bedded bay and swirling shore, and recirculate back from our ocean. Evaporation, condensation, precipitation. Access to water has defined where human populations have flourished. Civilization emerged between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers on the Fertile Crescent of Mesopotamia in modern-day Iraq. Now we are changing the carbon and nitrogen cycles. We are altering the global water system too, through damming, extraction, irrigation, and climate change. Many rivers no longer reach the sea. We move more sediment than natural erosion and rivers. We've built 48,000 large dams. We've drained half of global wetlands. We use an area the size of South America to grow our crops, an area the size of Africa for our livestock. Agriculture accounts for 70% of global freshwater use, and we need to feed a growing population. In a single lifetime, we've become a phenomenal global force. We are pushing Earth into a new geological epoch, the Anthropocene, dominated by humanity. We have altered Earth's snow cover, sea ice, and ocean volume, fundamental elements of the water cycle. Climate change will bring more flooding, drought, and disease. A warmer atmosphere holds more water vapor. This is causing the water cycle to intensify. Wet regions are becoming wetter, dry areas drier, rainfall patterns are changing. Damming, mining, and extraction are causing two-thirds of major deltas to sink. Almost 800 million people have no safe drinking water. 2.4 billion remain without adequate sanitation. 1.7 billion people live in places where groundwater is being extracted faster than it can be replenished. 4 out of 5 people worldwide face risk to their water security. For water security for all, we urgently need innovative and creative approaches to policy from local to global. With nations competing for limited resources, we must find better ways to manage them. And we must adapt to a changing water cycle. This is the Church of Water in the Anthropocene.
Thank you.
the lights are down and you can see it from the beginning. Is that okay with you? It's okay?
Yeah.
And it's Italian.
The title of that film? Carpe Diem. And I would like to say, you know the expression Carpe Diem? What does that mean in English? Seize the day, right? And I have to say, being here today with the chair of UNESCO being inaugurated, this is a very, very, very important day in Perugia. Because as you see from these three very different kinds of films, the methods and the tools available for talking about water are very, very varied. But each film sort of comes from a very different world. So the first one is really one that comes from a commercial world, almost a video clip quality, very serious camera work, really cool, really important message in a very appealing and kind of glamorous way. The second one is a movie that deals with a word that's very debated, the Anthropocene. What this word means, like when you study geological history and you study the different periods of huge time passing, what we are now looking at is that we, as human beings, are affecting nature. And we are calling it the Anthropocene. It's kind of a heavy word. I don't think people connect to it really well. But the group in Bonn, a team of scientists, that's called the Global Water System Project, they actually devoted an entire conference to the word Anthropocene. And they used this video as a way of opening the session, to have something visual and catchy. And what that film is data. How many of you are actually in water science in this room? And how many of you are in other subjects? What other subjects are you studying? Linguistics? And what else? Any communications specialty people? In any event, what that movie is are data sets that scientists have created and have put visual images to the data. So what you're actually looking at is numbers of information. So lines that are coming up from the earth represent the amount of dams. The swirling images are NASA satellite images that reflect patterns of weather around the planet. There are many, many, many. There is a little tiny word in the corner, dams, that tell you what the data is about that you are in fact looking at. Is that a successful film or not? I'm not sure. Maybe we'll talk about that in a minute. And the last one is a film that was made by the Center for Science and Environment in New Delhi. The woman that's the head of that organization, Sunita Narain, actually won the Water Prize in the Stockholm Water Week, which is a very important meeting about water technically and scientifically. And they use very, very precise language to express what they want to say about water. This year's conference is actually going to be about the water and energy nexus, which is a tremendously complex subject because the water people don't really get a lot of money to study water, and the energy people are the big gorillas of the earth, as you well know. So it's going to be a very interesting conference. The third one is really something that wakes you up to the potential for solutions in a way that I think is very successful. It's simple, it's short, it's engaging, and it also tells a message about rainwater harvesting, which is one of the simplest low-tech solutions for managing rainwater. And the reason we picked these three was to give you a nice taste of the variety of film that you actually have available to you or can make about the water crisis. And all morning we were hearing about the reality of the water crisis, but what is very exciting about being in Perugia and being at this university in particular, University of Foreigners, is that there is an openness to linking different disciplines, but in a very real way, not just like a fake way. And so you have here on campus some of the best professors that I have met in all the years I've gone to conferences that take very seriously communicating science and using creative approaches like Vox Teca. Have you heard of Vox Teca? Do you use it at all or engage with it at all? And if you look at the website, which is just up recently, and this is the wonderful Antonella Lamana, who's here today, has created a library of recordings that you can have access to. And today we also just inaugurated something called the Unifactory, which is another sort of a space for people to get together and experiment and create products and tools that communicate water science. And so it's a very exciting moment to be here. It's a great day to be in Perugia because the UNESCO chair was inaugurated and these new facilities were inaugurated. And I'd like to know if any of the professors who have been invited into the session would like to come up here and say a few words, or actually maybe one at a time come and say something about anything, communication, or the films that we just saw, or can I continue? I can continue. I can continue. That's excellent. So let me ask you what you thought of the films. Yeah, which one do you prefer? Which did you like the best? Let's start with the first one. Who liked the first one best, the Carpe Diem? Don't be shy. I am not shy, as you can tell. And who liked the second one best? And who liked the third one best? Yes, we sort of tried to figure out what would be the best sequence. How many found the middle one, the one about the Anthropocene? Did you get anything from it? Were you able to understand the narration? Were you able to understand that it was data? I find it very confounding until I watched it about 20 times. And after I watched it just now, I realized this puts so much valuable information in one space. How many of you feel like you got something from it? By the way, I have a website. It's called Let's Talk About Water, Parliamo dell'Acqua, but in English. And I have those films on there, so you can actually watch them again. They're called Short Films and Visualizations. I also have a collection of about 300 films. About 60 of them are posted on my website in description. And I go around to various universities with a program, and I do either a long-form documentary or dramas. I mix and match kinds of films, and we talk about them. So when I was invited here, we were trying to figure out whether we should show a long film, or a short film, or these short films. So what do you think is... Oh, so the thing I wanted to say is that this morning, what was very, very exciting was that in the presentations, in honor of the UNESCO chair, and by the way, I wanted to thank Chiara Buscarini. Yes, no, it's close, but it's not right. What is it, really? Biscarini. For having invited us and for the University of Perugia, the University of Foreigners to have me come here. I'm really very, very honored. What was I saying? Do you remember? Were you listening? What? This morning. So the thing is, when I've gone to all these conferences, I've worked on a project about the brain. I worked on a project about the brain for 6 years. What was it? It was 10 programs, and it was 2 textbooks. So I did the photo research for the textbooks, I worked with a medical illustrator who did all the drawings about the brain. In the beginning of developing this project, they decided they wanted the set of the show to be a very big brain that somebody could walk through. You will not believe this when I tell you. And who they decided were going to be the host was actually a man in a wheelchair, which is amazing that they would think the guy can go through this brain. And then when they did the budget for the actual building of the brain, which was then going to be submitted to a museum, it's like a joke. I know it's like a joke, but when I was young and a young professional and they were making all these big decisions and I thought they knew what they were doing, and then you realize nobody really knows what they are doing, that the set was going to cost more than the TV series. And the TV series was already like $10 million, so the set was going to be like another $6 million. It's like ridiculous. But in this kind of work, you realize that you have to match image and text and information to be able to express very complicated ideas. And this show was very, very successful, in fact, on public television, and the books were very successful as well. But this morning, when I started working with water, when I started working on the brain, in order to get the research for the information, for the images, you go to conferences. Have any of you been to scientific conferences where it's one subject and people do posters, and you look at posters and you see the collection of the data, the collection of the graphs and the information? It's a very, very fascinating world. The graduate students stand in the front and they talk to you about things. And I passed one, and I thought, this is a beautiful one about a very dry land area. And I said, this is great. I can see the photographs of the arroyas and everything. And the kid said to me, oh yes, I'm glad you like the photos. My professor told me there were too many photographs. And so then you go to the speeches of the professors, and they have their PowerPoints. And the PowerPoints are expressing data or concepts or information. And sometimes they're engaging and sometimes they're not. Well, this morning, I saw the most beautiful PowerPoint presentations I have ever seen, because the water crisis is really serious, and how to express the blend between the science, the engineering, the data, and the landform, the geography of where these things are happening, coupled with photography, which is what we have in this beautiful landscape and what Rolanda was talking about before. When you find a way to synthesize, it's one thing to have a university that has all the specialties, but the idea of integration and synthesis is where the challenge is. And what you come up against is sometimes you make an effort to do it and you fail. But in this instance, the two depictions of Chiara's work and also Fernando Nardi, who just joined the faculty here, were so compelling that I think it's almost to be submitted to Cinema Ambiente as an idea to say these are film materials, these are elements of what could build into a very beautiful, artful film where you really actually link science to art and you actually build a bridge between the two with something that's a legacy that we can then understand this very serious subject and hopefully become creative about what we do about it. I mean, it's one thing to describe it, it's one thing to measure it, it's one thing to describe it, it's one thing to try to reach a public knowledge, but it's another thing to try to find the solutions. And so I am now going to attempt to speak Italian, and you can't laugh, okay? And I'm going to speak slowly, and then anyone who wants to come up and speak, the professors can. Ogni, no, I better continue with my next. Ogni giorno che qualcosa di nuovo. Nick, you come up and say it. I think it's better. My Italian is frighteningly bad. You think so? Okay, fine. Without the glasses. Ready? Okay. Because this is the truth of it all. Ogni giorno c'è qualcosa di nuovo. Sta a ciascuno di noi riuscire a trovarlo. Non smettere mai di sperimentare, vivere, apprendere. Thank you very much.
davvero a tutti. Some questions for Linda. And also for the students, if they want something. I have a question about the title of Let's Talk About Water. I'm a researcher on interaction. I study interaction. So I was wondering whether in the title Let's Talk About the Water, you conceive a way in which it is important to study or to analyze situations in which people talk about the water to each other. Because I think that with Chiara we've been very often thinking about how to put together our two competencies and knowledges in projects. But since my, for instance, my interest is in analyzing interaction, the way in which people talk about things in an ordinary way, so I was wondering whether you can see something that involves, you know, ordinary people talking together about this subject. Because what we've seen is, you know, communication in terms of communicating, you know, expert communicating to lay people about something scientific. So I was wondering whether you, and Let's Talk About the Water, you include also the way lay people concepts or idea about the water, about the use of the water, about what the water comes from, or if there's something that can connect with what I'm doing.
Thank you. Again, I can't tell you how exciting it is to be here at one place where the two dynamics are analyzed. I think one of the important things, I mean, when I conceptualized Let's Talk About Water, the title, it was, of course, over a coffee when I was at a university, and we had to make up a title really quickly, and we had to put it on a poster, and we said, okay, let's talk about water. So it comes, creativity comes in weird forms. And the thing is that one of the big issues in the subject, if you think of the hierarchy of water management, you start with the water problem. So you have hydrologists studying the water problems. Then you see what the problems are. You have to go to the next level, which is local management. Then you go up a step to deal with the public that's around it, the stakeholders in the area who are having the land that has the water, that has the land, that has the gauges on it, that uses water. There's a beautiful lecture this morning about law and the idea of a river, and the fact that there's rivers, there's people in the area of the river who have the rights about where they live, and then there are people who fish and people who use it for transportation, and they have rights as well, but they actually are conflicting in times. So when you look at the picture of water in a holistic way, you basically are looking up the hierarchy of the chain of hierarchy up to politics and then money. And the power is always where the money is. That's why I said before the idea of energy and water in Sweden is going to be a very interesting conference, because the energy guys are going to come in with the great graphics and the big music, and the water people are going to have all the data, and who's going to come away with knowing much about energy? They hide the information really skillfully. So the idea of talking about water, I think when I say that I found as an entry point to climate change, the idea of water, it was a very big relief, because I find that the thing about science and engineering, it's not just that they talk to each other and don't communicate with us, but it's very hard to formulate the question about a subject that you don't really know, and you don't have building blocks of ideas in order to put them together to form a sense of the subject. When you are a policymaker or a manager, you need tools like the GIS that we saw this morning. You then need to talk about it. So in a way, you almost have to have the motivation to talk about it, which then creates the need for the language to talk about it. And I think the general population is in denial about how serious the problem is, and that we only wait until the crisis happens. Then we wonder why everyone isn't giving us the money. This is another part of the wonderful colloquium this morning. The idea that we wait till the crisis, and then we want the money to pay for the house that got... And I'm from New York City. I mean, you come from New York City, you think none of this is going to happen because you live in Manhattan. You have tall buildings. And there's my son going from the 16th floor because of the explosion in the electric company during the Hurricane Sandy, taking the baby and the wife and with the carriage down 16 flights of stairs and walking from 10th Street to 75th Street in the dark. This is Manhattan. I mean, this is unbelievable to me that this is happening in many, many places. In Sardinia, there were floods. Sardinia doesn't have floods of that nature. Liguria is having floods constantly now. Places where there was no flooding, they say this expression, it's a 100-year flood. I used to hear that expression, and just like the show The Anthropocene, you think to yourself, so you wait 100 years, I have one flood, I'm not going to have to worry again. And then someone joked that the floods for the politicians were every 4 years, because that's when they were in their term, or wherever the years are. But the reality is that these events are happening faster. The data is proving that they're happening faster. So the public needs to know. They don't really want to know. I'm becoming very Italian in my way of answering the question. I'm talking. I'm from New York, so very Italian community. Am I answering your question? It has so many facets, what you've asked.
Partially, yes.
What am I missing?
Come and tell me what I'm missing, because I feel like I'm just...
I was just asking myself whether in your program, in your idea of, in your research program, in your scheme, there's a place for interaction. So it's a place for instance, how to teach people to talk to deal with water, how to make people more sensitive about this way, or are you interested in the way in which mothers talk to children about how to save water, or interaction, people that talk together, are you interested in these things, or is just, you know, or it's just, it isn't allowed, or it's not just, and not, you know, trying to minimize it, but it is, you know, scientists, ideas, numbers, that goes to the population. Are you interested also in the way in which normal people talk about water, or the idea they have, the description they have about the water, or about this situation, or what about the shortage of water? What do people talk, how do normal people talk about it?
I mean, one of the things, if you look at the website, there are many, many films. So one film we were gonna show today was about melting glaciers, and the fact that it's really happening, and someone took photos. They became very obsessive and they climbed into all the glacial areas and suffered a great deal and had beautiful time-lapse imagery of melting glaciers. It's very interesting when you talk. I would love to hear your idea someday or even now. I don't, when you have a film about glacial melt or you have a film about energy like fracking, and with hydrofracking, it's so polluting that you can actually light your water on fire from your tap. You turn your water on, you light it with a lighter, and the whole set's on fire because there's gas that has mixed with the water. So when each film is shown, whether it's a long film or a short film, the discussion becomes a different conversation. But I think you're asking a slightly different question, which is the way people interact. When does this subject come up? And how can we make it come up more often? And at what level will people communicate with each other with information? So I think one thing I've noticed in terms of environmentalism, which I think is a very difficult word and should be expunged a little bit because it's like means everything and nothing at the same time, it's really the younger generation who feel the concern, who are learning about it in school, and who go home and yell at their parents. You shouldn't use so much plastic bags. You shouldn't drink bottled water. You know, you need to take awareness. It was actually coming in the opposite direction, from young to old. But I'm very fascinated by your question, actually, and it could be something that I do add to it, but it's a very interesting... does anyone have any ideas of how we could do this in a session? Like, if we were in a session like this, how we would break the groups up or have people just turn to their neighbor and say something. But this isn't the moment to do that, but maybe next time. But it's a really wonderful question. Thank you very much, very stimulating. Yes, it's food for thought, which is wonderful. Thank you, I appreciate it. Any other questions? That was such a good one. Oh, please, you must have questions. Yes. Do you want to come up and speak in the microphone? Yeah, come up. And I want to get at least 5 more questions, so I won't let you out of the room. And introduce yourself.
Yes. Good afternoon, madam. My name is Stella Trocca, and I'm attending the first years of pre-ed from Mission of Italy Abroad. I'd like to ask you if you could describe us through a metaphor what water represents for you. I don't know, as you are a woman of heart, so maybe. No? Okay.
What it means to me?
Yeah.
This is a funny question because I become obsessed with it, which is a very strange experience. It's funny, I was reading an article in New York, the International New York Times, they call it now, it used to be the Herald Tribune, about mania. What is mania? There was a story about a boy in China when he was in the after the Cultural Revolution, and they were really poor, and they didn't have really food. They ate very bad food, and so rice was a big luxury. And the boy, when it snowed, he thought the snow was rice, and he took out all the buckets, and he made all his friends put the buckets around to get the snow, thinking it was rice, and it turned into water. So he was like very shocked and very disappointed, and he was very fascinated by the idea of what drove him to do this. And he said, what is mania? What is a mania is an obsession about something irrational that you cannot stop doing. You understand what I mean? It's an obsession, and you feel like in a way it's irrational, but you cannot stop doing it. So when I worked on the global warming exhibit, and it hit me like a light bulb, this is so huge, this problem, and the science of it is so complex. And I work as a communicator in a film picture research way to communicate ideas. I want to spend time doing this. This was in 1992, so this is almost 21 years ago. And I have friends who say, please, do not talk about water. Instead of, let's talk about water, they beg me to shut up. Because I have become obsessed. And the reason I become obsessed is because I think water is a very poetic subject. It ranges very broadly from the beauty of water to a feeling that it's your life is water, your body is water, that it's something that, it's funny because as I was coming from Florence to Perugia, it was mountains, 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 more mountains, mountains, mountains. We were going up and up and up, and then up and up and up, and I thought, oh my God, where is this place, Perugia? They kept saying it was up and up and up, but this is more up than I wanted. And I said, I miss water, I miss seeing water. And then all of a sudden, I look out the window and I see water, and I said, what's this water? And this was this beautiful lake you have here. Yes, I was shocked. And it was big. It's a big lake. And then we had a wonderful discussion because there's going to be a big lake conference. There's a new, very deep interest now in lakes. And so there's a lot of people working, and there's going to be a conference here in September. And I might come back again, but I'm not sure. But the thing is, it's not only our body. It's not only beautiful. It's part of religious rituals. It's part of the landscape, it's part of what's inside of trees, it's virtual water, which is what Francesca studies, it's in our food. And so when we pollute it, when we let it evaporate, when it shouldn't be evaporating, when the weather systems are so chaotic all of a sudden, when we don't know how to dress, you know, you go out to go where, and you think it's spring, but it's really cold, or it's in the summer and suddenly it's pouring rain, we are getting disoriented. First of all, migration of species. Does anyone know what that means? You have so much change in climate that planting seasons have changed, birds are migrating north to colder climates, other animal species are moving. So this is Earth systems, natural systems that we grew up with, are actually adapting. That is in fact the whole point of Anthropocene, the way man affects nature. So it is something that I became obsessed with in every part of myself. It's really a problem. So I appreciate your question.
Thank you.
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 Thank you. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you for coming up. Okay, you got four more. It's like American Idol. Yeah, come on, you gotta pick on someone. What? Oh yes, you can speak in Italian. She can translate, that's what she just told me. In Italiano? Per piacere. So now I'd like to introduce this very handsome young man that's up here, and I'm going to let him take the show over, and I can sit down and catch my breath. Thank you very much.
No, sì, velocemente per concludere mostriamo anche noi i nostri prodotti cinematografici locali che riguardano le risorse idriche. Due anni fa ormai è stata fatta la prima edizione di questo film festival in collaborazione con l'Università per Stranieri, la Voxteca e l'Umbria Water Festival, che si chiama Acqua Doc, e sono arrivati più di 100 film, più di 100 contributi a questo premio, che è stato questo evento che poi è stato organizzato per il 99% qui dagli addetti, dai professori ricercatori di questa università. E adesso vi vorrei mostrare insieme ad Antonello Lamanna, che è un altro assistente ricercatore che lavora qui con noi, sia dei brevi spezzoni dei vincitori che una breve sigla che è stata creata da lui, che si chiama Morfema, che è stata molto apprezzata anche da Linda, che parla appunto delle trasformazioni dell'acqua con molte citazioni. Adesso ve ne introdurrà direttamente l'autore.
Grazie intanto per la parola, grazie a Linda, grazie, dico grazie a tutti perché ieri ho dimenticato alcuni nomi, ho creato un po' di imbarazzi, insomma, non voglio ripetere un po' di errori, insomma, quindi ringrazio tutti quelli che vedo e anche gli assenti. Io volevo soltanto dire due parole su questo festival, ma più che altro sull'idea, cioè come mai in una università degli stranieri, per stranieri, dove ci sono discipline linguistiche, di comunicazione, di grafica, di ingegneria, esiste anche, cioè, questo tema dell'acqua, come mai, qual è il legame che lega questi aspetti di ricerca, insomma, questi temi a varie discipline. Innanzitutto, cioè, l'acqua, già non so se credo molti di voi hanno conosciuto, insomma, i filmati o hanno sentito parlare di Robert Fierty, che è stato uno dei primi pionieri documentaristi americani, che già fino al 1952, che è la data della sua morte, e che il primo documentario parlava di pescatori, cioè Nanook eschimese, parlava di fish, no? Parlava di imbarcazioni, cioè storie e narrazioni molto brevi. Comunque l'acqua ritorna come elemento vitale, ma l'acqua noi l'abbiamo conosciuta, anzi io ho conosciuto il mondo dell'acqua nella ricerca grazie alla collaborazione del professor Panitti, che è direttore scientifico di uno dei progetti internazionali che si chiama ALLI, che è l'acronimo di Atlante Linguistico degli Aree Italiani, e che è stato un progetto che ha coinvolto circa 15 università. È stata un'indagine nata nel 1983 e sono state fatte delle ricerche in circa 100 località, 100 laghi, ma anche comunità che vivono questi laghi. Ma noi dei laghi di che cosa ci occupiamo? Cioè, ci sono degli aspetti, Linda ha spiegato il mondo della metafora, il mondo del cinema applicato alla didattica essere più incisivi nel mondo sociale, nel mondo civile, anche nel mondo non addetta ai lavori, insomma. Con questo progetto invece siamo riusciti a occuparci dell'aspetto culturale, che è fondamentale, specialmente oggi, che è stata una giornata importante per l'Università per Stranieri, perché è stata assegnata la cattedra UNESCO, è stato già detto, con la presenza della, della direttrice Jiménez Blanca del, dell'UNESCO, insieme al professor Batista, al professor Lubertini, al professor Maciola, alla Chiara, Chiara Piscarini. Adesso senza, senza annoiarvi, insomma, rientro e vi faccio vedere con Morfema, cioè ritorniamo a parlare delle acque nostre, cioè è una sigla che noi siamo riusciti a, a ricostruire inserendo del, degli insert audio che sono le recitazioni di pescatori, cioè di interviste fatte durante questo corso di anni, e poi le immagini, cioè non hanno bisogno di didascalie perché una sigla può essere personalissima ma non ha un tema, cioè ha un tema delle quattro stagioni, cioè totale riprese in più, e poi vi faccio vedere degli spezzoni dei film vincitori di questo festival. C'è sparita?
musicista che ha voluto vedere questo progetto, poi è durato 2 anni insomma, per fare questo 5 minuti da folli, però l'abbiamo concepita per questo tipo di sigla, e la musica è stata scritta, è stata elaborata pensando all'acqua, pensando a tutte queste forme, ai ritmi, alle frequenze, alla trasformazione di queste. Ora invece faccio vedere brevemente invece i vincitori dell'Astro Pop Film Festival del 2012, dell'edizione 0, spero che non rimanga a 0, ma con fin da lì si può parlare di numero 1, di number 1, del festival Napoli, del next festival.
Che promozione allo stato di
Porta questo secchio giallo, che anche dal punto di vista, anche se è solo plastica, ma per il suo colore, per la sua velocità, per come passa, porta questa risorsa in superficie, è veramente molto toccante. Infatti l'Africa, che è un paese, noi pensiamo privo di acqua, in realtà è uno dei paesi che ha più acqua, ma è acqua resiliente, che vive in delle sacche che sono sottoterra, che andrebbero solo scoperte. Quindi ecco, quando affiora quest'acqua arrivano le oasi, arriva quindi la vita anche in questi posti. Queste sono delle tecniche utilizzate da questi pastori per riuscire a portare in superficie la risorsa idrica. E quindi penso che sia piaciuto anche a voi, è stato veramente... Poi ha vinto moltissimi premi, dopo il nostro, che era uno dei primi, vero Antonello? Ah. Sì, ecco, aggiungiamo qualcosa, però ecco, qualche impressione anche da voi, dai professori che sono presenti, il professor Patinti, e concludiamo, insomma.
No, volevo aggiungere tanto una piccola cosa, che quando siamo riusciti a scoprire questo documentario, abbiamo avuto la fortuna che i due registi, che poi sono tre registi, cioè sono tre autori, ma c'è un regista, poi regista, autore è una cosa complicata, comunque sono tutti e tre registi, però è uno che coordina tutti i lavori, si trovavano ancora in Etiopia, perché la prima versione di questo documentario è stato quello che ha vinto il secondo premio, è stato il nostro, e dopo hanno avuto una serie di premi internazionali. Ci raccontava il regista russo, uno degli autori, che non so se avete visto, cioè questo pozzo che viene accumulata l'acqua per molti anni e viene custodita come fosse un cavò, cioè è un cavò d'acqua, e c'è una sorta di convenzione rituale tra le tribù, e loro praticamente hanno abitato in queste zone, cioè pensate ai cameraman dietro con 50 gradi, con tutte le difficoltà, cioè per arrivare a questo pozzo, cioè il loro accampamento era a circa un'ora e mezza di distanza, e quando questi pastori gli spiegavano che loro con 2 litri di acqua si riuscivano a lavare e a fare bere le pecore, avevano l'imbarazzo a portarsi molta acqua, perché c'era una sensibilità nei loro confronti, insomma, quindi si nascondevano, oppure cioè, hanno fatto la scommessa di se riuscivano anche loro a stare con 3 litri d'acqua, ma hanno raccontato che non ci sono riusciti, perché è impossibile, insomma, no? Questa è una piccola cosa fuori dal documentario. Se c'è qualche domanda, qualche curiosità, qualche dubbio, qualche... Linda, se vuoi fare qualche... Sì. Quindi chiudiamo e ringraziamo per l'attenzione, ringraziamo tutti quelli che hanno partecipato, quelli che hanno aderito a voi al nostro progetto, all'Unifactory, a Piero Margutti, da Patrizia Manili, cioè tutti i docenti e ricercatori che sono qui, che vedo in sala, insomma, sono stati anche i primi a, a credere in questo progetto. La parola a Linda Lilienfeld.
I want to thank you so much for being such a wonderful audience. You really are great. And it's such an honor to be here. And it's funny because everything sometimes seems very chaotic. When I came here, I wasn't sure where I was going, what I was doing, what was happening now, what was happening then. And everything has so much spirit and so much warmth and so much love and so much real creativity, that the session goes and goes and goes, and suddenly we have a wonderful session, and the best part was that we end with these very beautiful films from Aqueduct, because the films stand by themselves, and they are the way we can talk to each other, they are the way we can learn, and they are the way we can see the beauty that is water. Thank you very much.